Yarana! Welcome back, everybody. Oh, I need to adjust my cam here a little bit, cover my green screen. Thank you once again for joining me here for another Tahitian Moment Live. I took the week off last week. I had a couple people say, oh, where are you going on vacation? And I didn't really go anywhere on vacation. I was still working, but I took a vacation from the Tahitian Moment Live Thursday show just in the summertime. I think a lot of people are out and about and doing other things. And so I'm going to probably take a break. You know, that one time in July, I'll probably do a break once in August as well. But happy to be back here again this week and happy to bring you something completely different. You know, so many times I'm talking about early on in COVID, it was all about COVID, but then it was all about the different hotels and the tours and, you know, some of the introductions to the islands and what the different islands are like. And so this time, this is a topic that really can be useful to anybody traveling anywhere in the world. But of course, we love this little place behind me here and being the beautiful Bora Bora, this particular picture being the St. Regis Bora Bora. But today we're going to talk all about getting that perfect picture and doing it on your cell phone, because realistically, that's what so many of us use to get our pictures these days is our cell phones, because they're getting so good at taking pictures. So for those of you, as I say every week, for those of you that don't know me, my name's Carl. And I own and operate Tahiti by Carl. And what I do is I work with travelers to take the complexity out of planning and booking customized, memorable Tahitian vacations. So I'm your one-stop shop from the time you come to me for the quote, through the whole planning process, through the booking process. I give you travel tips. I give you information along the way before you travel, your travel documents. And then I'm there with you while you're away if you need anything right until you get back home. And it is crazy sometimes what happens in between that nobody ever suspects. Like last week when a big, huge ocean swell came through and closed all water activities in Bora Bora. It does not happen often whatsoever, but when it does, it's certainly nice that you've got a little somebody there to help you out in getting things canceled and rebooked and refunded and this and that and whatever else you may need. So, so keep me in mind when you are looking to plan your trip to Tahiti. As always, I love for you guys to say hello. Let us know who's watching, because I only know how many people. I don't know who. So say hello, but also, you know, really important, interact and ask any questions that you may have, you know, along the way, because I am doing this live right now. And I have a very special guest joining with me who some of you might recognize from previous shows, who is a professional photographer and has like the best gallery down in Bora Bora, located at St. Regis Bora Bora. And let me just do a quick little video introduction here first, and then I will bring him on. One second.
Bora Bora and the islands of the French Polynesia. Experience this unforgettable journey in your home. Kincaid Galleries, handcrafted fine art prints. Let your memories last a lifetime.
And here we are. Welcome, John.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
Yes. Well, I really thank you for coming back, coming back on here once again. John and I have developed this friendship through our common love of French Polynesia. And we were just saying right before the show, we still haven't met in person, which we swear is going to happen one of these days, possibly on November 1st, when he's flying out and I'm flying in.
Yes. Yeah. one day.
Yes, one day we will. But for everybody that's watching us, this is John Kincaid. John owns Kincaid Galleries. You can go to kincaidgalleries.com to see all of his work, but all the pictures that you will see throughout today's presentation, be at the back of the slides and everything we show, are all some of his magnificent photos, which I absolutely love. And you can see, like I say, on his website and on his Instagram channel. So yes, John, thank you so much for joining.
No problem.
Just quickly before we start, hello, Larry. Thank you for joining once again. Larry's with me almost every week, and we are in the process of revamping Larry's quote for him and his wife to get down to Tahiti in 2023. So thanks, Larry, for joining. So today we're going to talk all about pictures and who better to do it with than you?
Well, yeah, and I actually my cell phone is with me. My mobile phone is with me the entire time when I'm doing professional photography with my camera. Like it's a necessary tool for me. Sometimes I'll just do little video clips and everything. It's I can't live without it. Yeah. And the majority of everything I post on social media is all from my phone. So yeah. I can definitely give some tips. Now, granted, a lot of the pictures I'll be showing today are not from the phone, but at least, you know, we'll use it as reference.
Yeah. No, it's good to point out and stuff. So but it is amazing how the quality of the stuff. I mean, I for one, because I used to carry around, you know, the SLR camera and the DSLR, and oh, man, I love the fact that cell phones are so good now. It's so quick. It's so easy. I can upload to the social media right away. You know, gone are the days where you had to put it on your computer and then, you know, upload it to wherever. And
yes. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. The big cameras, I mean, nothing's processed. You have to take it back, you know, get it all edited, get it ready. For me, it's exactly what I need, you know, but I rely on my mobile phone heavily on all of these trips.
Yeah.
Particularly in the planes, you know, all these little quick things where you just can't get out your big camera and it's all have to worry about what lens you're going to change and everything. So that's a very valuable tool.
Yeah, for sure. Just a couple more hellos here, John, before we go on. Just Dana, thank you for joining. Dana is in the process of, I'm just waiting for her final confirmations to come in, also heading down there in 2023. So take good notes today, Dana, for your upcoming trip. Dave Dontremont, Dave is back from his trip. And yes, Dave, we do need to connect. I have been meaning to do that for a long time. So I can go through some of the pictures with him. I swear it's one of the hardest parts. I'm so, so busy right now. I have such a hard time keeping up with the quotes and the quotes and the bookings. And then I could sit for hours and talk to people about their trips. I ran out of time. It's hard, but Dave, we will connect for sure. Dave, you're one of my closest clients too. We should get together for a drink, even though you're not that close. But and who else do we have here? Liz, sorry, I'm late. That's all right, Liz. You are ever faithful and join every single week. So thank you again for joining. I thought for sure, Liz, with this heat, you'd be out at the pool, not watching, not watching us live here. So, okay, so let's move on. So let's talk about how these people are going to get amazing pictures.
All right. So there's a few basics that I try to tell people. During the pandemic, I actually was in, say, at the St. Regis when everything was locked down, and I just gave a few tours and everything. Kind of, it was surprising how many people didn't do a couple of these little things that they could just make their photos better immediately. So I'll go through these three points, and we have screenshots that will kind of help you along and figure out what you need to do here. Mm-hmm. The first is turning on the grid lines on your phone. So when you start your camera, when you're looking through it, you've got a 9-block section. And it's just, again, just regular grid lines to help you frame your picture. And it's amazing what you can start to see when the grid lines just help with everything. You're like, oh, I don't want it perfectly centered. I want it off in the third. The second is, and I'm not sure about the brand new iPhones, but a lot of the iPhones, and again, I'm an iPhone expert. I'm going to default to Carl for everything else, going in and changing your video settings to 4K or higher. I think they're pretty much all 4K right now. it's worth doing unless you're really tight on space or something. It's just, you're going to get a lot better video quality when you're sharing it, when you're, if you ever want to use it in video clips or montages, or there's so many different software packages that you can start to do these things with, and you want the highest quality video settings you can get. And then slow-mo, which a lot of people forget about, and it's just a lot of fun to play with. You know, somebody diving into the pool, in this case, diving into the, into the water off their overwater villa. It's, you know, you'd like to get at least 120 frames per second, but ideally the 240 frames per second. So those are three things that, you know, I try to, two of them are video, one of them's photos, but we can go to the next slide and we can kind of show you where they're at.
And for me, the grid lines is one that I have always used and I completely love. And I did do my video settings a long time ago too, but the slow-mo is one I've never even thought about looking at. I have no idea what my settings are at.
Because if you're only at 60 frames per second on the slow-mo, it's just going to be really choppy. So the 240, it's just going to really give you all the everything you need to get a really clean slow motion video. So on the left is a screenshot of the iPhone, and the right is the Android. And on the left, you'll see record video is at 4K, record slow-mo is at 1080. And then just down under composition in the next section, it says grid, and you just want to turn that on. And then on the right-hand side for the Android, grid lines is on the bottom right.
Yeah, and it has all those other settings too, but everything didn't show on one thing, but everyone can find the settings in your cameras, so.
Yeah, we were talking before this started too, we'd love to find out if people are using iPhones or Android.
Anybody that's watching, if you, I wish I could do a poll. This software doesn't allow me to do a poll. We're curious to see how many people, how many people are iPhone people versus how many people are Android users. If you want to drop a comment, I'll watch the comments and then we can kind of tally it up here and see if people comment. So it would be great.
Okay, so this is a picture. This is one of my shots, and I just kind of want to talk about it. So when the grid lines are on, you can see in photography, there's a term, rule of thirds. I typically, like, that's a rule, I don't want to follow it, but it does have its merits, meaning that if something is placed on the thirds in any one of those, like on the line, on the top or the bottom, the horizontal or vertical lines, that the picture is going to seem more appealing. And this was just done a long, long time ago where people thought, you know, just kind of judging a picture. So you'll see sometimes when there's just a really simple photograph with only one object in it, typically it's in one of the third columns. It's rarely centered, although sometimes it is. But again, kind of think about the rule of thirds. It also does something. So like if somebody is walking along this beach, you'd want to kind of have them on the third marker because it kind of shows progress of where they're going. You know, that there's something in front of them. So if you are doing portrait shots, it is really important to use that third marker because it does help with motion. And I'll just kind of describe this shot a little bit. I've got the sun exactly on the, which doesn't always happen. It's kind of rough, right on the third marker. I've got the palm kind of close, but more importantly, I've got that path that kind of leads you into this beach. And this is behind the St. Regis Bora Bora. So this is on the reef side, as we call it. I don't know if there's an actually name for it, but we always call it the reef side because it just kind of drops off. And you get the best sunrises behind the St. Regis. It's one of my favorite places to shoot. So again, this is just kind of, you know, I've got the green, foliage right there in the front, and you can kind of, it feels like you can just walk into this picture. That's really kind of just helping with the composition. So that's one reason we like to use that rule of thirds with the grid lines.
And I find the grid lines, it just reminds me of the rule of thirds, you know, matter how much you actually use the grid lines to line it up or whatever, just when you've got them on the phone, it makes you think about that.
Because you'll start to see, like, if you're taking somebody standing on the edge of the villa or something like that, you're like, okay, I've got their head in the rule of, you know, up in the top. And then you're like, oh, I cut their feet off, you know, so it does kind of help you stop and frame the shot a little bit when you've got these turned on. I do really recommend it.
Nice.
Now the next thing is the wide angle. If you can go back one slide really quickly. As you see here on the iPhone, it's got the 0.5, the 1x, and the 2. And that's an easy way to switch if you want to use a wide angle, is the 0.5, where it really gives you that wide angle view, and the 2 is zoomed in. And I I can't remember on the Droid, I'm sorry, if it's got the similar type of zooming or if you kind of click and drag.
Yeah,
so if you want to move forward again, sorry to make you bounce around like that. Yeah. These are both shot with a wide angle. And I don't really, you know, encourage people to use wide angle too much in Bora Bora particularly. For those of you who've been there, you can see how small Mount Anamanu is right now. It's just tiny. And when you're standing at this dock is the first dock that you go to before you get out to all the villas. To your left would be Lagoon Restaurant. And it really minimizes that mountain. And it right now, the picture on the right is just kind of a bridge. It does kind of show everything, but to me, as a professional photographer, it's not that interesting. It could have more. Mm-hmm. Now, the picture on the left, if you have somebody that wants to, like, here I am, I'm going out to the villas and the mountains in the back, and you can kind of capture it all in one. But, and she was a concierge at the St. Regis. She's no longer there, but she was my subject for this. And, but, you know, this is a good time to, this is just held up a little bit higher than her. So she's all in the picture, and then you can kind of get that view. And that's one good time to use the wide angle. And there's a lot of others. If you're, on your, by the pool or anything like that, you kind of want to get everything in. It's nice, but it does really take away from the magnitude of that mountain in that place sometimes. Mm-hmm. And then the next slide is that kind of shows, if you walk up just a little to the left and look at the mountain, this is a zoomed in view. So this would be close to what the two is, and you can kind of see it really kind of showcases. Again, this is still small. This isn't totally zoomed in or really show how impressive the mountain is, but it kind of makes you feel more of the vision that you normally would have. So it kind of really brings it in. And this performed extremely well for me on social media. And it was this one was taken with an iPhone. I loved the shot, and I quick got my camera out, set up the tripod, and I did everything. But a lot of times I'll just walk around and that's how I'll frame it.
Nice.
Okay. All right. So portrait versus landscape. I get to people watch a lot because I typically travel alone. My wife hates it that I work so much on these. So I'm there alone. So I see everybody that kind of goes. So I try to recommend there are special moments that you have at these places. And a lot of times you don't really realize them until maybe you actually come back the second time, which I know is weird to say, and I'm not trying to encourage quick booking another trip, but you're like, for me, it took me a while. The first time I was ever there, that bridge that was in that previous picture, when we drove over it, I was kind of like looking both ways. And I was like getting actually right behind Carl. That shot is one of the most impactful moments I had when I was first at the St. Regis, because I was like, it was just a glimpse, like going through, I'm like, oh my God, I'm at this paradise. Like there's villas, and then you peek through to this, amazing mountain. I was just in heaven. And when you find those, you'll kind of recognize them because you'll feel something. And I try to encourage people to use that feeling instead of just like a good view. A good view rarely translates into an amazing picture. So when you do find those moments, I encourage people to do shoot landscape and portrait. So, and then if you have the time, take a little 10, 15 second video clip of it as well. And it will kind of get into why I want to do it later, but you'll find that if you take a portrait shot and then you want to use it as a wallpaper on your computer, you're like, oh my God, I've got the bars on each side, or I have to zoom in. It doesn't look good. Or you've taken one in landscape and then you're going to upload it to social media. And while you can do that, it just doesn't take up as much real estate, and you're cropping things. So it's good just to take both. And sometimes by doing that, again, you've got the grid lines. You're like, oh, this is a better shot. And it just kind of helps you do it. But the video clips, I can't speak for everybody. And this is just, my opinion of it, but with Instagram trying to compete with, TikTok and everything so much, the reels that I've been uploading lately are far more successful than any images that I've been doing. And it's 10 or 15 seconds. And sometimes it's just in one spot where you just kind of see the water moving or palm trees or whatever it might be. But the other nice thing is too, I know iPhone does it, I'm sure Android does it, but the memories, it kind of comes up and you've got this like 15 second video clip and you're like, oh, This is great. This is what I'd love to do. So it's I wouldn't go around and just, you know, shooting everything like this, moving earth, like just take the time and, you know, take a deep breath and like, wow, and just enjoy it. And then if it's really impactful, take the time and do both, you know, and make sure you've captured it, you know, and adjusting it really will help you.
It's funny you say that, because a couple of things that you just said, I mean, the number of times I've looked at it or taken like portrait and landscape, and then afterwards think, wow, what a difference. Like, why did I take that? You know,
yeah.
Like you sometimes think the one's going to be the best, especially once you get it off your phone onto like a bigger screen, and then you realize, you know, oh boy, what a difference.
Yep.
But then with the videos too, I've started doing that every time I go down, and I make them exactly 10 seconds. So it's easy for me when I'm going through my videos to know, oh, this is just like a scenery shot, or it's just, you know, it's not somebody diving in the water or whatever. I know anything that's exactly 10 seconds is just a moment, a little scenery thing, a little something that I might use for my Instagram, but I'm horrible with doing reels. I have not got enough reels.
Yeah. It's and I do see a lot of people too that they are constantly taking photos too. And I like to, you know, I mean, as a professional photographer, I'm like, take some time and just, you know, enjoy it. You know, like don't have to wait till you get back on the, you know, viewing everything on the plane on your phone. Like, make sure you're enjoying it too, and it's not all on your phone. It's easy to get sucked into it, especially when you want to like broadcast everybody like, I'm in paradise, I'm going to make you jealous, you know, but, you know, take some time.
Yeah. Okay. Maybe before we go to the next one, I have had some comments come in on our iPhone versus Androids. And we also have a few questions here. So first of all, Brad, thank you for joining us. We are going to talk about the GoPros and underwater photography coming up, right?
Yep.
So stay tuned, Brad. We'll get to that. Questions. One second here. Larry has a question. Discovering my iPhone camera, I notice it has f-stop settings. Any suggestions?
I mean, if you want to, so the lower the number of your f-stop, it's going to blur the background a little bit more. So if you like, I've got this lens for my professional camera. It's a F2. So that's like if I'm doing something for a portrait and I want to blur everything. If you're doing landscape, you typically want everything in focus. But that doesn't mean use the highest number either, because it's confusing and I hate it. I wish I could make my own camera. I usually stick between F8 and F11 for my landscape shots on my professional camera. The you know, depending which model phone you have, but definitely play with it. Although I will have to say, like, if you use portrait mode on your iPhone, that's when it blurs the background and everything. It does have its own software that applies to it. So like if you're taking a picture of somebody in front of a fence, you will see it goes haywire sometimes. So like it's a nice blur, and then somebody can buy the fence, it's like super pixelated and blurry. Mm-hmm. Automatic settings on iPhones are very good, but it's definitely worth, you know, playing with the f-stop. If you really want to blur things out more, just go to the lower number.
Yeah. I think it's one of those things you need to practice and learn it before you go, like we were saying earlier.
Yes.
And know what you're doing when you're there. And nowadays, the automatic are so good that unless you're really, really good at it and you really want to get into it, you know, the automatic settings are pretty, pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's tally up our iPhone versus Android here. So Larry, as we know, is using an iPhone and also a GoPro. Dana is also an iPhone. Liz is also an iPhone 12 mini. Oh, I didn't even know they had minis. Hooray, Brad, he's in my Android camp.
I told you, iPhones are going to win.
We're losing though, Brad. We're losing because Tony and Eva both use iPhones. Tony, Eva, thanks for joining. They are off to go down to Tahiti real soon. Dave Dontremont, also iPhone, but also has a Canon as his main camera with a few lenses, and Fujifilm XP130 underwater film. So that's a film camera, Dave.
Nice. I shoot Fuji. Well, right now, Fuji and Sony.
Nice. Did I get everybody? Larry, iPhone.
Yep.
iPhone. And then one more comment here from Liz. Live in the moment and enjoy the pictures and videos later.
Yes.
It is true that sometimes, especially me, when I get down there and I'm trying to capture everything for work reasons, sometimes it is hard to stop and live in the moment. But I also think it's important to review what you've done, because if you screwed anything up today, you might be able to redo it tomorrow. And if you don't look at it today, and a week from now you're back home, you know, that lagoon's gone. So you do want to have a little bit of a look. But again, you do it before you go is such a, you know, so good to learn your equipment before you leave.
All right. So we just kind of, we talked about those special moments, and we'll kind of go through in a few of the spots, particularly at the St. Regis here. Again, you'll know them. I guess for me, it took me a while to identify them for myself, and it's helped make me successful selling these prints, because I walk around, I try to get it. It is difficult when you're on a honeymoon or you're there with a partner, be like, okay, I need to sit in this spot right now and I need to wait for all the cleaning carts to go away or something, or there's no people in it. I do have that advantage going by myself You know, to help, you know, really narrow in that special moment. But one of the things I wanted to kind of talk about is when you're there, some of the things to shoot and like, to don't forget the foreground. Again, a good view is not necessarily a good photo. So I think one of the next pictures is what I think most people will see when they go there. This is standing on one of the villas. This is Villa 114 at the St. Regis. And I see a lot of people, they go out to the edge of the dock and they take the picture and they've got the mountain and they've got the blue water. And it's not a bad picture, but you know, when you're at this moment, you have to realize that you're happy to be there because you are on an overwater villa. You know, so try to remember like, okay, why am I in heaven right now? Like, okay, I'm at this luxury overwater villa. I've got this amazing view. I can just dive right in. And by bringing that into the shot, you know, and of course I get all artsy with the, I'd wait for these reflections and everything to come in off the windows, and you can see into the villa too. But, when you're on, you know, in this experience here, make sure, even, you know, it's a lot of fun. A lot of people do it. They have their feet in it too. Like they're sitting at the edge of the dock and they swing their feet up and, you're like, I'm here. And that definitely helps, you know, helps the photo. It helps you place it in a position. So instead of like, oh, here's a really cool mountain with some amazing blue water, like this kind of, again, puts you in that spot for forever.
Yeah.
And that's what I was going for. So, and then the next one is, which I've seen a lot of people take. This is one of my favorite places to shoot at the St. Regis behind the spa. And this is the Lagunarium. And even on really windy days, this is almost perfectly calm. And it's just incredible. And a lot of people will just go up and they'll shoot just the top half of this. And they'll get a great shot. But you just step back a little bit and look, and you can see these amazing shadows of the palm trees. You've got the shadows of the clouds. And you've got this mirror reflection. And anytime you have water like that, you know, in tropical environments, it rains a little bit. If you see it raining and it's going to clear up, get outside and have the sun to your back, because there's going to be a rainbow. Or, you know, go up to the signs and like kind of get down low and you can get a reflection of like the, you know, welcome to St. Regis Bora Bora sign or something. Or there's a lot of things you can do with water with this. You know, inside the lagoon, it's a little choppy, but where you wouldn't get this perfect reflection. But really look at the foreground when you're going out there and kind of looking at everything. Yeah. Not just the end goal. It's just a little photographer trip. Trick. Yeah. Okay.
Beautiful. That is a favorite spot. We actually can do, if anybody's going, we can do incredible romantic beach dinners there right at that spot with that view, and it's so private and beautiful.
I've shot, you know, when they do setups for everything there, and the detail that they do with, you know, the torches, you know, all lined up along the side of the beach, and then the table, and it's just so calm. That would be my number one place to have a private dinner.
Yeah, because it's truly private.
Yes, yeah. It's so great. And then they spoil it rotten. Like,
I always tell my clients, romantic beach dinners are amazing, but a romantic beach dinner at every resort can be very, very different from one resort to the next. So it's
yeah.
But this is such an incredible spot. So.
Yeah. Underwater. Okay. So we are now granted this is for phones. So I wanted to bring this up because this is something you cannot get right now in the French Polynesia. And unfortunately for a couple of you, Carl included, these are only made for iPhones right now. But this has been one of the most valuable tools that I've had when I'm going there. And you can either just get the base unit on the right there, which is just where your iPhone pops in. You close the lid and you can touch the back of it just like you normally would. There's like a small film that goes over it. Or on the left, you can get the dome, which we'll talk about in a second, and the trigger. So anybody that, even if you just have a GoPro, I highly recommend getting the handles because it just helps you stabilize. If anybody's ever used a GoPro underwater before, typically the first time you go back and you look at your photos from that day, you're like swimming, you're like looking at the bottom, or you're like looking up at the sky, and you're kind of missing out. It's pretty hard, unless you're diving and you're a seasoned diver, to like really focus on what you're doing with those. And this is just an incredibly valuable tool that it's not that expensive, but it's worth getting and practicing before you go. Mm-hmm. And the dome, what it does for any of you that have seen the over-unders, they're called, where it's the bottom half is underwater and the top, you can see the sky. The dome displaces the water right in front of it just a little bit like this. So the advantage for the over-unders is you get to see all the marine life, but then it also places you in that spot. My favorite underwater shot, we'll show here in a second, sorry, is underwater completely, but it's not nearly as good of a seller as this one, I believe. And what I've been told is it's because you can see the mountain in it too. This is where they place you. And for any of you that have not been to Bora Bora or have been, this is the spot that they go for the shark and ray tours. So this isn't somewhere custom that I just went. I was with Lagoon Service, and they drop you right here, and you get the butterfly fish most of the time. Yeah. You see a lot more sharks than this. I will let you know that this took 8 trips to get this shot because there's just so many sharks, and I really just wanted one in the shot. And I wanted it at a certain time where I can see the shadow and everything, again, the foreground. But so you'll see a lot more, and then a lot of stingrays too. And then the other one, Requin, is underwater. Again, it's very lucky shot. I was just this is like 4 feet of water, but this is wide angle. So that's why it kind of brings everything up. And the tour guy from Lagoon Service thought it'd be funny to throw some of the fish food right at my head. We're there all the time and we mess around. They will not do that to you. Don't worry. So anyway, the shark just kind of like just turned really quick, and the butterfly fish just in this perfect crescent moon. And I was able to get the shot. And this is the type of stuff that if you have that trigger, you know, if you're underwater, even with the dome underwater, you can kind of really capture all of this stuff and that entire experience. But the advantage of with the iPhone is you can just be filming all of this. You can do, again, I'd want you to do it in portrait and landscape, and then you're able to upload it right away. I highly recommend that. And I did speak to Aquatech, and I've used them before, and they've offered a 10% discount for anybody that's interested off of the package deals. And I believe Carl will be putting in the code and the link in the description below.
Yeah, so there's the code there, which I guess isn't too hard to remember because it's your name, and Access Go is the name of the name of the equipment, -USA. So, but I will, after we're finished this, with this video goes on to YouTube and it stays on my YouTube channel. So in the YouTube description, I'll put the actual link and the promo code in there as well. So so if anybody is going and has an iPhone, unfortunately for people like me, this won't work, but yeah, you can go ahead and do that.
And I guess a quick tip that has never worked for me, by the way, but it works for everyone else. For the domes, when you're shooting the over-under, you're going to get to a point where you have a lot of water droplets on the dome, on the part that's out of water. Most people, divers and everything, they actually spit in their mask, and that helps prevent from fogging, and it also creates that lubricant. I must have defective spit or something. It just doesn't work for me. So I had to find another solution, but I do mine really quick. So it's underwater and I come up and then I take the shot. Mm-hmm. But if you're in a really calm environment, like if it's really, really flat, you can get some amazing shots. It's a lot of fun to play with. They're great for any overwater villa experience because you can just dive in. Again, the slow-mo feature, again, don't forget about like all the video stuff. You can have your significant other or friend up on the dock, and you can have them dive into the water. There's just a lot of fun things you can do. And it's a little bit easier with the dome than the GoPros. I don't know if they have a GoPro dome or not, but that's just for me. And I know, Carl, you've had experience with the GoPro.
So the GoPro is for the GoPro for me. I just bought my first GoPro before I went to Tahiti last year. And I think the biggest thing that I really learned is that you got to practice using these things before you go, because I got down there and I was so excited to have it. But again, when I get down there, I am busy because for me, it's also a work trip. So I'm meeting with people and I'm trying to post and blog the whole trip and so on and so forth. But I didn't, not that the GoPro itself disappointed me. I disappointed myself in the fact that I didn't learn how to use the GoPro well enough to take, to take full advantage of it. And also not being on my camera, it meant that I had to upload things and then probably edit things. And all of that takes time, which I tend to not have a lot of. So most definitely with any of these lovely toys that we love to buy, practice before you go, really get used to your equipment before you get down there.
And without the dome, this Access Go has been great. You just jump in and you're taking a photo like you would normally. It's been great.
Yeah. The filters are driving you nuts, Larry. I didn't even know they had filters. Now, John, you're not a GoPro user, are you?
I had them before, and I learned right away, like, don't travel that with the batteries in the GoPro because it'll just be dead the next day. And like, it wasn't for me. It just wasn't for me at the time. I really have, leaned more now towards the for underwater quick video shots. I've got the Aquatech housing and everything for my professional cameras and stuff, but I don't want to carry on that much stuff. And the iPhone has been great. It's my one tool that I use all the time.
Yeah. Well, I have to say after doing this, I'm thinking, even though I have the GoPro, I'm thinking to get an underwater housing for my camera, was almost because I know how to use my camera so well. It just almost makes.
I can ask Aquatech too. I believe they maybe even sent me one too for the professional cameras. They have it's instead of Access Go, it's the Aquatech stuff, and I think they've offered a 10% discount on that as well too. So I'll send you that link.
Cool. Just what else do we have here? Oh, Dave for his underwater camera saying it's digital, not film. Okay. That kind of makes sense. I was surprised to be a film in this age. I used to work at a Japan camera developing pictures many, many years ago. Larry again, may I suggest a camera handle with a lanyard which goes around the wrist? Absolutely. You don't want to drop your underwater camera when you're.
Oh, that's nice thing about that pistol grip handle. It comes with the wrist wrap.
Wrist up, yeah. And I know the one that I bought for my GoPro, the handle I brought for my GoPro is a float. So if you did drop it, it's got a wrist strap on it as well. But if you did drop it, it's not going to sink to the bottom. It will float up to the
same thing with the dome feature. It'll float, which is really nice.
Yeah.
And they do have like the small, like I think Amazon sells them, like they almost look like Ziploc bags that your phone can go in. They're okay. I can't live without my phone. I need it for business and everything. So I have always been leery. They might work just fine, but it's not something I can risk, taking.
I know.
And you don't get those cool over-unders either. That's another feature.
Yeah.
Okay.
And one more comment here, Liz. We could use an underwater camera on our trip. Liz, you're going to have to go back. One day, Liz, we'll get you back there. Okay, so that's it for comments for now. Let's go, what do we got next? Next, nighttime and time lapse.
So nighttime is, the night photography is one of my favorite. It's extremely difficult to do, to do for print, you know, to make sure that there's no noise and everything. It takes a long, long time to get it right, and you have to get lucky. But the iPhone 13, I know for sure, has got a really good feature now where you can actually get the Milky Way. It's got great low-level light, and I believe Androids, you know, they're constantly competing, so I'm pretty sure with one is going to work on the other.
Yeah.
So the newest cameras are great, and when you're looking at the stars, particularly in the French Polynesia, in Rangiroa, you're flat out going to see pretty detailed because it's just so remote. Mm-hmm. But when you're in Bora Bora, when you look up, it's almost going to look like a thin strip of clouds. Like you're like, it's not a cloud, but it looks like it. And that's the Milky Way. And it's definitely visible this time of year. And that's something where you can do it handheld. Now, the other thing is these gimbals, like we have pictured here. For the longest time, I would do my walkthroughs and things like this with a gimbal. I personally have a curse with gimbals. They work great for like 5 minutes, and then it just has a mind of its own and it flips off to the side. And I'm shooting with an iPhone 11 Pro right now, and it's got incredible stabilization just handheld. Carl and I were talking about that earlier. I'm running after my toddler with it, and it's stable. So I don't feel like I need one anymore. But the nice part about these is they come with a little tripod, so you can actually do a time lapse if you want it. There's some features on some of these gimbals that are worth looking at. So if you want to set it out and, you know, it takes a picture every 5 seconds and it combines into a nice time lapse for you. It's just sitting there while you're having drinks at Lagoon or wherever you might be. They are valuable. And if you have an older iPhone that doesn't have the stabilization, which you can figure out pretty quickly, just take a video and go walk. You'll find out if it looks like it's bumping like you're walking, it's not on. But these are worth looking at. And I know Carl uses his quite a bit.
Yeah. I got that again before I went down last November. I bought the latest, greatest one. You know, I always like to have the kind of the best stuff because it usually has new features. And I really do enjoy it. And it was able to, you know, with the clasp around it, I could put it over my case and just keep it on and pop it on and off quick and easy, you know, which made a big difference. But I use it every time, and you'll see me, if anybody goes to my YouTube channel and you see me do like at the St. Regis, I did a room tour of the premier overwater villa that I was staying in. And if you watch when I hit the bathrooms, I go by a mirror, you'll always see me, and you'll see I've got the gimbal, you know, because I do enjoy using that. That is one that I've taken to and I quite like when I...
They are nice for selfies, actually, and filming yourself if you need to as well. I realized that I actually do... Maybe I need to get another one. Like, they have a follow mode, so you can click on it and then click on yourself, and it'll just pan with you. So if you need to walk... again, I'm shooting by myself, but I want to, you know, have, you know, behind the scenes. So I would just use this, and that would shoot it for me.
Yeah.
So there is some value. I do like the DJI one, but there's a lot of them out there on the market.
Yeah, tons. And this was my second DJI one, and after researching, that's the one I kind of decided to stick with too. But now the problem is you don't use it all the time, and I forget. So when I go back down again, I have to pull it out and practice because I forget how to use it and what all these features are, which I don't use half of them, but it's still good to, you know.
Yeah.
Good to have. So I think, did we have another picture in your gallery to show here too?
This one was not taken with a phone, but I have to take so many. So this one is very lucky because there's typically clouds. You know, the mountains make clouds, and maybe 3 times a year you get cloudless nights. And there's a couple floating off, but I started at just after sunset, and I ended up shooting through till 2 a.m.
Wow.
And I think there's 70 or 80 shots, and it took me 4 months to put it together. Just to get this in this level of detail. Because I wanted this, you know, something where, you know, not religiously, but like a heaven and earth meet, you know, kind of like, you know, the sky. I was just, you know, this is one of those places where I want to show everything. And I've got Lagoon restaurants and villas. But this was with extremely wide angle lens. So I'm going back this summer. I've got another shot planned. Well, hopefully the weather will cooperate, but it'll kind of bring the mountain into more of the what I need it to be and include the Milky Way.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Yeah, I love it. It's fun to shoot.
Yeah.
And then the last one, I think we saw
another picture.
The helicopter and drones.
Oh yeah.
Oh okay.
They have social media and helicopter drones.
Oh okay.
Which you kind of touched on, right? About doing the reels, which this is, you can see here, video.
Yeah, they're all reels. Yeah. And it's just fun to, you know, people see there. I wouldn't do them too long. You know, everybody, especially on Instagram, has a very short attention span, and just the interesting shots. And it's pretty easy. Light. Put some nice music to it that you enjoy.
Yeah.
That goes. I know there's sometimes that I don't, but I would recommend trying reels for sure.
Yeah. And for anybody that's about to go to Tahiti, especially if you're staying in the St. Regis Bora Bora, check out John's Instagram account. Look at his gallery online, because, you know, sometimes it's a matter of seeing where other, you know, when you see those pictures that people love so much, it's like, where did they take it? You know, and analyze, what did I love about that picture so much? And then when you're down there, you can try to, try to get those shots too.
Yeah.
Or just buy it on John's Gallery.
Definitely go there. And we have a plan that at some point we're going to put little placards where it'll be like a, and there's an app that we're making so people can walk around the resort and it'll kind of buzz up and say, this is a good photo opportunity spot. So
that's cool.
Yeah. I talked to the GM about it, and it's on me at this point. I have to finish it. So get all the geolocation done, but it's just, you know, just to have it in there. Because if you can get the spot yourself, it matters.
Yeah.
I shoot with a 100-megapixel Fuji camera, and I can blow it up to 8 feet wide. That you cannot do with your phone. And I have the time to make sure I can get these best shots and everything. So there's a little bit of difference. But yeah, check out my Instagram if you want to know where some of these are. Mine are split between a few islands now, between Rangiroa, Tetiaroa, Bora Bora, and Moorea. And I'm just going to more and more.
Yeah. Actually, I noticed if anybody is looking too, you're going to any of those islands, because if you go on your gallery site, you've got it broken down by island. So people can and resort, like, you know, if you want to see, if you're staying at the Conrad, you know, like there's some shots of the Conrad, there's some shots of the Sofitel in Moorea, there's some shots of the Kiora in Rangiroa. So,
and if you're a night sky lover, I would highly recommend Kiora. I was blown away. Just at the night sky there. And I went during a new moon, and I was still able to get, so, you know, I went during a full moon. I'm sorry. I got that backwards. So, I was waiting for the moon to come up, and I was just like sitting at the main dock, and I look up and I see that cloud. I'm like, oh my God, the Milky Way is out. So I was able to get Milky Way shots, and then I ran over as fast as I could over to the ocean side. And I got the moon coming up over the water.
Oh, nice.
Pretty cool.
Nice.
But yeah, that's a tremendous place. That it's very remote and
you middle of nowhere, like, right?
Yeah. Literally, it's nowhere, nothing around.
Yeah. It's special.
All right. So this shot is the bestseller for Bora Bora, and it was taken with a helicopter. And I took it at this angle because it kind of makes Bora Bora look like a heart. So the back end over there would be where the airport is, and you can see the Four Seasons and the St. Regis and the older Meridian, and then Intercontinental there. But this is where I was able to kind of get the shot, and then I had my better camera so I can get incredible detail with it. I get a lot of people messaging me on Instagram about drone usage and things like that, and I would just recommend not taking your drone. For a lot of reasons. One, it's just not allowed at the resorts because of privacy. You're basically in the flight path at the St. Regis and at the Four Seasons. So you don't want to get anywhere near that. I know you get some really good shots and everything, but it's just not worth, trying to take one and get out there. It's unfortunate, but as a professional photographer that has shot drones at the St. Regis, and you know, the guests were informed that I was on the property, that I was going to be flying a drone. It's funny, you still get pretty nasty looks. It's a big privacy, you know, issue, like having a drone fly up over, you're like, no, I don't, I know what's happening and I still don't like it. You know, it's one of those things. So
especially that would be my recommendation. Resorts. Yeah. The higher end resorts, you know, people really don't. Well, like say, it's totally not allowed. Right. So, so I know people do bring their drones and I know some of the pictures can be amazing, but just don't go down there thinking you're going to sit there in your water bungalow and launch your drone because that's not.
It's just not safe. I mean, you might think like you could look at the Air Tahiti, you know, arrival and departure schedules, but that doesn't show all the private jets coming
in. Exactly. Yeah.
It doesn't show there. Each of these resorts have a helicopter pad too. Yeah, like you said. Yeah. There's a very good chance you would hit something. And that's, I believe, in the French Polynesia, because they use France laws, I think it's like a $90,000 fine and up to like 10 years in prison. So just something you just don't want to do. So that's my word. But however, the helicopter, you know, I've been on a few times now. That's my favorite thing to do probably next to the shark and ray.
Yeah.
Easily.
Yeah. The helicopter is really the view. I mean, I do more and more helicopter transfers for people coming from Tahoe over to Bora Bora or vice versa. You know, and it's so spectacular. And then just scenic helicopter flights as well around the island. It's amazing what you
If you can splurge for it, get the one where you can land on Tupai.
Tupai, yeah.
That's a special trip.
You know, and then I always say to people, I don't know if you've done it, John, have you done the ATV tour with Toiki?
I haven't done it yet. That's the one thing I have not done.
You should do it. You got to do the one with Toiki. So the ATV, I always say if you can't afford the helicopter, scenic helicopter flights, the ATV tour that he does goes up to the top of Mount Popoiti and your views, you know, it's not 360, but the views are really incredible. You get such great views from up there on that ATV tour.
I did walk up there.
Did you? Yeah.
Yeah. I wouldn't recommend that. I would definitely do the ATV tour.
But yeah, the views are just amazing, and it's just such a fun outing. It's the next best thing to a helicopter aerial view, I say, when you're doing that tour. So.
Yes.
Yeah. We have a question. Who runs the chopper tours if we wanted to go up and take some aerial photos?
And you have to recommend you request doors off. Otherwise, you have to shoot through a small window. You could do it. Actually, this shot up on the screen here is shot through that window. So it is possible, but I would definitely recommend the doors off tour. It just, when I was there, it was being used in Tahiti, that helicopter that does that for a different reason. But
yeah. And Harold says he'll show me how to use his GoPro. Yes, Harold just came back. John, him and his family just came back. They had an amazing trip. Now we're planning their return trip. But Harold's a very avid photographer, and he got some incredible shots on his trip down there. So
I'd love to see
that. Harold, I'm gonna come hang out in your pool, and we'll play with GoPros. Good. And then I think that was all we had.
Yeah. And I'm more than happy to answer questions on Instagram or Facebook or just, you know, any of the chats on my site, go right to me and to you. I get it all the time. And it's not a bother in any way.
Yeah. Does anybody have any other questions while we are still both here live on the show? And if you are watching this as a repeat, of course, drop the questions into the YouTube channel because I try to answer them all in there as well. If you have any questions, and if I don't know the answers, I can get in touch with John and have him shoot a comment back there as well. But if anybody has any other questions, feel free to ask now. Liz, you're very, very welcome. And I know you have a big world out there to see and explore before you head back, but I feel like it's your bit of your passion here. So one day, maybe you'll turn around and head back again. But thanks as always, Liz, for joining. And thank you everybody for joining. John, thank you for coming. This is, I think, your third time?
Third or fourth,
Because we've done some live. If anybody is, you know, you go back on my YouTube channel, there's a lot of videos in there. But we've had, John and I have done, we did one one live when you were down at the St. Regis, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So we did a live when that was kind of during, that was during COVID, talking a little bit about what COVID was like. But it's always a pleasure having you on here again. Thanks, Dave. Glad you enjoyed it tonight. And what else we got? Jersey Mike. I joined in late, so this may have been covered, but any recommendations or words of advice on how much camera gear is allowed on flights?
So check with your, if it is diving related, you show your dive card, you can actually get a extra allowance. I know on Air Tahiti Nui for sure, which usually covers, you know, the extra gear that I need. Mm. Otherwise, you're just stuck with the, which I don't remember offhand, it's like 20 kilogram.
So yeah, your regular, your check bag is the same as the big carriers when you do your inter-island flights. So you're looking at basically 50 pounds for a checked bag, but your carry-on bags are very, very small on Air Tahiti Nui. So if it doesn't fit in the overhead, which is really only big enough for a backpack, that has to become part of your checked bags. And that becomes part of your luggage allowance as well. So, Harold, all your camera gear, I don't know if you're still here, Harold, if you made it okay with all your camera gear, because I know you had quite a bit of it to bring down, but we'll just see if Harold does.
Use this 1535 Pelican Air. It's light enough, and I don't have to worry about anything getting crushed. I haven't had an issue, although the inner island flights, the Air Tahiti's, I do have to check it. Nothing fits in those planes ever.
It's a backpack. It's really just a backpack that fits in the overhead.
It can't be like a thick backpack. So like if you're one of those people like a loose backpack, and it'll fit up in the top. So be prepared if you have like a gear like this. And then for any other photographers that are going, I also do have another big Pelican case. They always come out at a different section. There's like the main rotation where all the bags are, and then there's a separate section off to the left where they have like the bigger like
fragile items.
That's where your stuff can come out. So don't freak out when your expensive camera gear isn't coming around on the rotunda or whatever it is. It'll be over on the left.
Good. A few more comments here. Let's just see. Brad, thank you for a great show. Thinking about a Tahiti trip, will contact you, Carl. Yes, for sure, Brad. Please do reach out. It is my passion, and I think it's pretty safe to say it'll become yours if you go there too. Eva, thanks for all the information. Can't wait to be there in person. You know, Eva, just when I read that, I think I should start almost every week doing a picture from my clients' past trips. You know, feature one or two pictures. So if anybody's watching this and you're a client, pull out your favorite one or two photos, and then maybe over the next few weeks I can add that as a segment and just always put in a couple photos from my favorite photos from my clients, because I always love
to. We should do one for editing them some one of these times.
What's that?
We should do one of these live shows for editing your photos.
Oh yeah, we totally could do there's that.
I mean, every, like, if you rather you shoot raw or your iPhone, something is processing that photo. And I know a lot of times for me, that if you take the picture, the water doesn't seem quite right. It's very difficult to get that. So like adjusting the whites, or the blacks, or like, it's typically not just the exposure, like to get it to what you remember it was.
Yeah.
Yeah, we could do something like that.
Jersey, Mike, thanks. Thanks, Carl. That was my question, really. I guess my camera and lenses are all part of my 50 pounds a lot. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. But don't overpack on your clothes and everything. People always overpack. You live in t-shirt shorts, bathing suits. The islands are very casual. So cut down on that stuff for sure.
And cut down on your gear. That's coming from a photographer that would overpack like some of your longer lenses, just leave them at home. You're never going to use them. If you're carrying a bunch of primes, like just consider renting just a really solid zoom. You know, I have a 45 to 100 on my this one, and that's one of my best walk around ones. I still get a great shot. So just like packing your clothes, look at your camera gear, because 50 pounds is a lot, you know. And my first couple trips, that's what I would do. And now I've pared it all down into this one with two camera bodies and lenses. So
nice. Yeah. Liz has got her grid lines on. Nice. Way to go, Liz. That'll be for her upcoming river cruise. Liz is going nuts to Tahiti next, but she's doing a river cruise. Oh, glad you like that idea, Eva. Yeah, yeah. So I look forward to featuring one of your photos. So keep that in mind when you're down there taking your shots. And Mike, once again here, thinking 24 to 70 and 70 is 200.
I'd recommend a 16 to 35 too, just for fun. Yeah, I think you'll, especially if you're doing some underwater stuff, yeah, it'd be a lot of fun. Because 24 sometimes doesn't get wide enough depending where you're at. But you've obviously been there, so.
Yeah, by the picture, you're dreaming about it anyways, but so. Yeah. Excellent. Okay, John, thank you very much, everybody. No problem. Thank you for joining. If you enjoyed this, please give us a like, drop us a comment. It makes a big difference, and then we know. Please, if you're watching this and you're past clients of mine, shoot me those pictures, and maybe we will. I'll start trying to get that get featured once a week here when we do the shows. Thank you, Mike. I'm glad you enjoyed. And I can send you some of the photos for the show. Yeah, we've already had some of yours on, Dave, but for sure, send me, just give me like the two top favorite ones that you have. So I'm not the one picking and you don't say, oh, that wasn't the one that I thought was best. But yes, thanks everybody for joining. We will see you. If you're looking to go to Tahiti, please, please, please reach out to me, tahitibycarl.com. And John, thanks once again. And I hope to see you live in person on November 1st, but
November 1st,
to talk to you before that. November 1st on Tahiti. So
sounds good.
And we'll plan a trip together one of these days.
Yes.
All righty. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Take care. Have a good night.